The CPU, otherwise known as the Central Processing Unit, is the brain of the gaming PC. The CPU's responsibility is to calculate and process data. This component is one of the most expensive components in the system, the other component being the graphics processing unit. In the gaming system, this can cost 2 to 3 times more than the motherboard the CPU is being inserted into. The two types of CPUs available for the PC gaming market are Intel and AMD. The speed of a CPU is measured in gigahertz, which means billions of calculations per second. And this plays a huge part in choosing a CPU for your gaming rig where you will always want the fastest available processor. This is important where the CPU's role in gaming is calculating the game's logic, collision detection between characters and objects, loading, saving the game, keeping inventory and health points, artificial intelligence or AI, physics such as armor penetration, ballistic simulations, breakable environments, and any number of moving props, and input and audio processing. The different types of mainstream cores for a CPU are 2 cores, 4 cores, 6, 8, 10, and up to 32 cores. These are called multi-core processors, where it contains 2 or more processor cores in a single processor die. Why would you want more cores in your gaming rig? To use an example, we shall take a single core and a dual core to process programs such as Microsoft Office, Firefox, your Outlook email, and Adobe Photoshop that are running simultaneously. For a single core CPU, less time is committed to each running application as more applications are being opened. This will eventually slow down the PC big time unless some applications are closed. With a dual core processor, the workloads are divided among each core, causing the CPU to perform faster and achieve the application's tasks in a timely manner. With the dual core, more applications can open and run simultaneously without slowing the PC. Hyper-threaded cores are an extra thread or process on the CPU core where it is applied to applications where multiple tasks can be intelligently scheduled so there's no idle time on the processor. Heavy multitasking is an example of where hyper-threading can be utilized. It can help a CPU push light tasks such as applications running in the background or your favorite media player to one processor while having applications such as your games goes to another processor core. An example of a 10-core processor with no hyper-threading will be listed as 10/10, where the first number states the number of cores and the other number is listed as the number of threads. This is where one thread is allocated to one core on the processor. For a multi-core processor with hyper-threading, 2 threads are allocated per core on the processor. So a 10-core processor with hyper-threading, it will be listed as 10/20, where the second number is doubled, stating each CPU core contains 2 threads. As CPU speeds increases over the years, the memory speeds could not keep up with them. In order to minimize CPU idleness and delay, cache memory was integrated into the CPU. Cache memory is a high-speed memory buffer that temporarily stores data the processor needs, allowing CPU retrieval to be much faster as opposed to retrieving it from main memory. A buffer stores random data. A cache, on the other hand, holds the data the processor is most likely to need in advance of it actually being needed. This enables the processor to continue working at either full speed or close to it without having to wait for the data to be retrieved from slower main memory. Cache memory is made up of static RAM or SRAM integrated into the processor die. Low-cost processors typically include 2 levels of processor cache, being L1 or level 1 and L2 level 2. Mid-range and high-end CPUs also have L3 or level 3 cache. A level 1 cache is a memory cache that is directly built into the microprocessor, which is used for storing the processor's recently accessed information. Thus, it is also called the primary cache. It is also referred to as the internal cache or system cache. L1 cache is the fastest cache memory since it is already built into the chip with a zero-weight state interface, making it the most expensive cache among the CPU caches. However, it has limited size. It is used to store data that was accessed by the processor recently, critical files that need to be executed immediately, and it is the first cache to be accessed and processed when the processor itself performs a computer instruction. A level 2 cache is a CPU cache memory that is located outside and separate from the microprocessor chip core, although it is found on the same processor chip. Including L2 caches in microprocessor designs are very uncommon in modern CPUs, even though they may not be as fast as the L1 cache. But since it is outside of the core, the capacity can be increased and it is still faster than the main memory. A level 2 cache is also called a secondary cache or an external cache. A level 3 cache is a specialized cache that is used by the CPU and is usually built within the CPU module itself. It works together with the L1 and L2 cache to improve computer performance by preventing bottlenecks due to the fetch and execute cycle taking too long. The L3 cache feeds information to the L2 cache, which then forwards information to the L1 cache. Instructions are first searched in the L1 cache. If the instructions are not present in the L1 cache, then it looks into the L2 cache, which is a slightly larger pool of cache, thus accompanied by some latency. With each cache miss, it proceeds to the next level cache, which is the L3 cache, until it finds the data it needs. For processors, the TDP stands for Thermal Design Power, and it is used to measure the amount of heat a component, this being the processor, is expected to output when under load. For example, a CPU that has a TDP of 65 watts therefore is expected to output 65 watts worth of heat when in use. So, look for a CPU cooler that has the minimum or greater TDP of that standard to be able to dissipate the wasted heat properly to prevent overheating and an immediate shutdown of the PC. The manufacturing process of a processor refers to the size and line spacing of the individual circuits and transistors on the chip of the processor. With more recent processors, smaller manufacturing processes have been also used to make space available in each processor die for features such as multiple processor cores. For each generation of CPU, the process gets smaller. Example of CPU processes are 22 nanometers, 10 nanometers, 7 nanometers, and in the future, 5 nanometers. It makes all the difference in processor speed and considerable difference in power consumption. The lower the process, the more transistors can be stored within the same space of die, which will equate to a much faster processor with lower power consumption. The lower the process, the more transistors can be stored within the same space of die, which will equate to a much faster processor with lower power consumption. The same concept applies for GPUs as well. Intel and AMD have created a set of socket and slot designs for the processors. Each socket or slot is designed to support a different range of original and upgradable processors. For Intel, they use the LGA or Land Grid Array, where the pins are on the motherboard and not on the CPU. And AMD uses PGA or Pin Grid Array, where the pins are located on the CPU as opposed to the motherboard. The latest socket type for AMD uses the AM4 platform, whereas Intel uses the LGA 1200 platform. The number for Intel after the LGA abbreviation states the number of pins that are situated upon the CPU. So, an LGA 1151 CPU will not fit onto an LGA 1200 motherboard and vice versa. The processor number is one of the several factors, along with processor brand, specific system configurations, and system level benchmarks to be considered when choosing the right processor for your computer needs. Processor numbers for the Intel Core and AMD generation processors use an alphanumeric scheme based on generation and product line following the brand and its modifier. For example, the Intel Core i9 10900K processor, where Intel Core is the processor brand, i9 is the processor brand modifier, 10 is the processor generation indicator stating it is 10th generation. 900 is the SKU numeric digits, and key is the product line suffix stating it is an unlocked processor that can be used for overclocking. For Intel, a processor without this suffix will mean it will not be able to overclock. For AMD's AM4 socket, the following goes for its Ryzen architecture. For example, the Ryzen 9 3900X processor, where Ryzen is the processor brand, 9 is the segment where 3 is entry level, 5 is mainstream, 7 is high performance, and 9 is enthusiast. 3 is the processor generation indicator stating it is 3rd generation. 9 is the performance level where 2 to 3 is mainstream, 4, 5 or 6 is high performance, and 7, 8, 9 is the enthusiast or prosumer. 00 is the model number. Leave this option for speed bump or SKU differentiator. X is the high performance with XFR or extended frequency range, which means that the CPU will automatically boost higher than the non-X models. It should be known that all AMD Ryzen processors are unlocked. A PCI Express or PCIe lane consists of two differential signaling pairs, one to receive data and one to transmit data, and it is the basic unit of the PCIe bus. The number of PCI Express lanes provided to the CPU is the total number supported by the processor. Since we are only dealing with building a gaming PC, we will only talk about GPUs, which uses 16 PCIe lanes. So, look for a CPU that has 16 lanes or greater. The more PCIe lanes the CPU has, the more expansion cards it can support. For example, network cards, sound cards, USB hubs, etc. Depending on the number of lanes they will need in order to function at its maximum performance. Since the i9-10900K has 16 PCIe lanes, it can support a GPU because it surpasses the minimum requirements. Another form of processor upgrade is to set the processor speed to run faster than the rating on the chip. This is called overclocking. In many cases, you can get away with a certain amount of overclocking because Intel, AMD, and others often build safety margins into their ratings. So a chip rated for, say, 3 GHz might in fact run at 3.5 GHz or more, but instead be downrated to allow for a greater margin of reliability. By overclocking, you are using this margin and running the chip closer to its true maximum speed. I don't normally recommend overclocking for a novice, but if you are comfortable playing with your system settings and you can afford and are capable of dealing with potential consequences, overclocking might enable you to get another 10 to 20% or more performance from your system. Overclocking is usually applied to the processor, but it can also be applied to other components in the system, including memory, video cards, bus speeds, and more. When the chips run faster, they run hotter. So cooling upgrades and modifications usually go hand in hand with overclocking. Systems that run cool tend to be more stable and more reliable. So even if you don't overclock your system, ensuring that it runs cool is essential for trouble-free operation. Many systems are not properly designed or configured for optimal cooling, even at their standard speeds, much less when overclocked.